Nieuw-Zeeland is voor Europeanen natuurlijk ontdekt door Tasman en daarna door Cook. Maar pas een tijdje later kwamen de Europeanen zich hier vestigen. De meeste Europeanen die vestigen zich vreemd genoeg op het zuidelijke eiland. Hier 30 kilometer ten zuiden, vooral in Dunedin, de eerste stad van Nieuw-Zeeland. Maar toen ze hier kwamen, zo omstreeks 1848, was het eerste wat ze zagen van Nieuw-Zeeland. Dat puntje daar, waar nou die vuurtoren op staat, dat is het eerste stukje wat vooral de Engelsen, want eerst kwamen weer de Engelsen, voor het eerst zagen. We zijn hier dus in Dunedin, en dat ligt op het zuidelijke eiland van Nieuw-Zeeland. Dunedin ligt in de provincie Otago. Dunedin is een van de oudste steden van Nieuw-Zeeland, maar het heeft in ieder geval de oudste universiteit van het land, University of Otago. En er is natuurlijk ook het bijbehorende museum of Otago. Daar heb ik veel over gelezen en daar ben ik heel benieuwd naar en daarom ga ik nu na voltooiing van dit eigenaardige natuurkundige experiment eens kijken in dat museum. Is hier dus about African lions?
Yes, well,
these lions.
Yes, we don't. This museum doesn't anymore see it as its business to have animals that are not from the region. But these particular ones were actually—it's quite an unfortunate story. They were part of a zoo, and they escaped, and they were eventually shot, which.
And given to the museum.
And given to the museum.
Yes. That's only here. But they're here now in a closed room. What's happening here with this room?
Well, there are a lot of things wrong with this room. If you have a look at some of the animals in the cases, you'll find that they've been bleached by the ultraviolet light that's coming up through the ceiling.
That's the normal light. That's ultraviolet.
The normal daylight, yes. Yeah. And there's a lot of ultraviolet in it, which has bleached the animals over the decades. That's why you've got them covered at the moment.
Oh, I cover them again then. Absolutely.
Yes. Well. And yes, the plan is to refurbish this. We have to put ultraviolet filtering in the windows, and just the temperature goes up and down quite dramatically as well in here. So objects aren't so well preserved here. We intend to open it. We intend to have the kind of display that that it might have been. We're going to make an old-fashioned Victorian gallery here again.
When we say that the last moa died around about 350 to 400 years ago, what we're saying is that in fact that they probably became extinct in the North Island much earlier, maybe 500 to 600 years ago. And so in terms of that tradition, it's probably likely to have been totally lost. In terms of all the records we may have been able to gather, we have not been able to pick up any oral tradition of the relationship between the Maori and the moa, or anything to do with the hunting. The only images we have are one or two cave drawings which date back 400 to 500 years, which have rough images of moas.
Yeah. You can tell very enthusiastic about the bird. What's your fascination with this bird? That he's big, yes, I know, but...
Well, I think the thing in New Zealand, and to me, what is extraordinary is that, I mean, I can take you places in New Zealand where we can find deposits of 800 to 1,000 skeletons of these birds. Now, in this sense, it's a subfossil bird. And that's, just, to me, is quite extraordinary that you can still do that. Now, the thing is, obviously, that you can gather that there are a lot of discussions about the moas. What is the relationship of the moa to the kiwi? When did they die out? Did the Maori people kill them, or were they, in fact, part of natural extinctions? And we can start to talk about in terms of how the animals live. So some people believe that they only laid perhaps one egg or two eggs at a time, quite small eggs. I believe that they probably laid a lot of eggs at any one time. If you take Epiormis, the elephant bird, yeah, it laid a huge egg like this. It was probably one of the largest eggs ever. So there's a lot of very interesting scientific questions. In fact, one of the biggest ones is, in fact, how many species of moa there were. Now, given that we've got the bones, it's a very, very fascinating study.
And these are biological students. Well, bones are not rare, so.
No, they're very, very common indeed.
And how do we know these are moa bones?
Well, the structure of the bone itself is going to tell us basically what they are. They're still obviously quite hollow. These have been in the ground obviously for some time. The cancellous nature of this area here. But if you get hold of a bone like that, where it's got the bone is complete, then you can start to see that, in fact, that on these edges here, these processes, the nature of that articulation is very typically moa. There's almost no mistaking of what it is. This is a tarsal metatarsus in the fibula
but
there.
If you see here, I will put that bone in the bucket. If you see one moa, are you sure that the bones are from one specimen or from 10 different specimens?
It's a very, very good question. No,
thank because you. That
because that's been a big problem. Often, in fact, the bones are not from a single specimen. It's one of the reasons why at one stage it was considered to be 33 species of moas in New Zealand. And we've now brought it down to around about 11 because firstly we found that there were sex differences between the moas. And very often, in fact, this is one of the skeletons here, which is actually not a single moa. It's made up of the bones of different species of moas. Yeah. You see the differences even here in the vertebrae.
But are you sure, do you know that there is one skeleton that's from one moa bones?
Oh, yes.
That's complete, yes?
Yes, we do. We unfortunately, the very big one, this Pachyornis, that is certainly
that
a
one.
Single, this one here, yeah, is a single skeleton. There's no doubt about that. We know that fully. But the point you raise is very valid because a lot of these often were found in swamps and the bones, of course, would be mixed up. There would be young birds, there would be old birds, there would be different species. And some of the very early confusion about the numbers of moas arose because of that particular problem.
I can see here that the skeletons are from an exhibition hall, so to see. You see here the signs?
Right, yes.
That was a museum in the early days.
Yes, in the early, this was very much the old tradition, and I think quite an exciting tradition.
Yes, I do think so.
Of having natural history specimens, all the natural history specimens and the skeletons on display, and these were all on display at one time.
And are they coming back in museum?
They are going to in this museum, yes.
Yeah.
I feel very strongly about it because when I was this high, that's what used to excite me about museums.
Yes, me too.
And I think that that excitement is going out of museums in favour of pushing buttons and computer simulations, which has its place. But I think that there is also a place for lots of people who would find a great deal of excitement in this room.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about science books. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love
show me more?
Oh, yes. Because the other, one of the
Moa,
other...
Moa Gizzard,
Moa Gizzard
stones.
Right. And these were very typical or associated with almost all Moa finds, that you would get these quartz pebbles associated with the skeletons. These, of course, were to help the bird to grind up its food. Some really quite interesting questions about these, because it's been suggested, because they're all quartz, that Moas went round looking for quartz pebbles. I don't think they did. They didn't start off in the sense that they would be pieces of schist with quartz in, and after they'd been in the gizzard of the Moa for some time, of course, they end up as quartz because the softer parts are worn away. But
why preserving the stones? What can you see?
Well, it's really, well, I think it's quite interesting, because if we later on, I mean, we don't have the technology at the moment to find out where the Moa picked up these stones. Okay, so the Moas, I mean, we might find that they picked them up in central Otago, and this one came from Manapouri, which is way down in Fiordland. So this possibility, we can track where they may have come from, how far they roamed.
And do you think that's possible in the next future?
I think so, yes. I mean, we would never have thought of DNA analysis, mitochondrial DNA analysis 20 years ago, and what we can use it. I mean, that technique is probably one of the most powerful tools for the biologists has had since the microscope was invented. So we don't know, and one of our jobs in a museum is to make sure that things like this are preserved, some of the old skeletons, the bones, even if there are thousands of them, for scientists to work on in 50, 100, 200, 300 years' time, because they will be dealing with a totally different technology to what we have.
I'm in the Canterbury Museum now in a room stocked with bones. It's mainly Moa bones, I think.
Yes, virtually all Moa bones.
And you're in charge of the bones?
Yes, yes.
What's your function?
I mind the Moas.
Yes. Your function is especially the science of the Moa.
Right, yes, I'm a geologist, a paleontologist by training, but I specialise in Moas, yes.
What depressed me a little bit, I was here, I think, 12 years ago, and I saw a very old-fashioned 19th century museum, and now it's totally modernized.
It's being modernized, yes.
Why is that? Where is the museum of the museum? Where is the Victorian gallery?
There is a Victorian museum down the front, actually.
Yes.
There's a Victorian museum down there.
But not so much as years ago.
No. The main reason we're upgrading is that we had to strengthen our building for earthquake risk. By law, we had to strengthen it. And that's meant that we've had to strip out the whole inside of the museum and strengthen the building on the inside. And so we've had to replace all our displays. So we've really been forced to do this.
Oh, yes. But if you watch old photographs, you see a lot of Moas, skeletons, three, so in a row. And that's gone now.
We haven't had that for many years.
Yes.
We haven't had that since last century.
Yeah, but you see it on old photographs.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And where are that skeletons now?
A lot of them will be here, in this room, but taken to pieces.
Taken to pieces.
Right. A lot of material was sent overseas. Just, they're all there, but you can't store them like that. It's very difficult to store a mounted skeleton. It takes up a lot of room.
Yes.
So they're disassembled and put onto shelves. If we wanted to put them together again, we could.
Yeah. Downstairs there are two mounted skeletons behind glass.
Right.
Are these skeletons from one Moa? Is that sure? The bones
yes.
in one Moa
yes.
are from one Moa?
One Moa, yes.
You're sure then?
Yes, because they weren't found last century. They're relatively recent. The big one dates about the 1950s, and the other one's about the same age. So we know their history very well.
What amazes me is about the length of the Moa. I've read the length is 5 meters, 4 meters, 3 meters, 2 meters.
No.
What's the length? He was very big.
it was probably the tallest bird that ever lived. Yeah. The big moa, there's 11 species of moas.
Yeah.
Right, the big moa, if it stretched its head right up, might have gone to 3 meters.
You know the photograph of Mr. Owen standing
right
behind
yes
the mounted skeleton?
Yes.
Is that a good picture of the length, the tons of the moa or not?
No, because we don't think now that that's how they stood. And if you look at our big skeleton downstairs, yeah, you'll see that we've got it in a more relaxed, a more natural position. Back last century,
oh, we will stretch out.
They stretched them, yeah, to make them look as tall as possible.
Yeah, yeah.
And he might have done that if it was reaching up to eat up here, but normally it would have stood in a more relaxed position with its head in a bit of a loop.
Can you show me the largest bone of a moa here available?
Yes, I think I can.
There's a cameraman walking in front of you, so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let me have a look. Just one I can get out easily. Oh, let's try one of these.
So, and please come here, so. Yes. Right.
That's a pretty sizable bone.
That's a sizable one, yeah. That's the bone, which part of the body? Show to me, which this part?
Tibia.
This part?
Tibia. But in a bird, it's further up the leg, because their joints are in a different position.
That's very heavy one. How do you know this is a moa bone? Because so large?
Yes, and it's different to any other bird.
Yes.
You know, it's different to an ostrich or an emu or anything like that. There are differences.
Are moa bones rare in New Zealand or not? I've seen in Dunedin so many bones in here too. They are not rare.
They're not rare, no. We find them preserved in swamps and sand hills and caves and on archaeological sites. They're not uncommon.
If I want to have a bone for myself, what to do?
That wouldn't be possible. They're protected.
They're protected. All the regions are protected.
All moa bones are protected. You can't take them out of the country.
Don't know much about geography. Don't know much trigonometry. Don't know much about algebra. Don't know what a slide rule is for. But I know that one and one is two. And if this one could be with you, oh, what a wonderful world.
Derek! Thomas. That's an egg. That's one egg, you think?
I don't know. That's just something that people tend to gather this stuff up and bring it into the museum. But it's just from a rock shelter.
But Beverly, as a researcher, what can you do with this?
Not very much with that. Not very much with that.
Oh, you are a very honest lady.
Because that's been picked up by somebody and brought in. Now, if I had gone to the place where that was and excavated carefully and recovered it myself, it would have told me something about perhaps how many eggs there were there.
And the habitat where it was lying.
That sort of thing.
Yes.
By itself, it doesn't tell very much. The research I'm doing now is up in Marlborough at the top of this island. And I'm actually looking at it out in the field where it is. You know, it's not much use to me in the museum like that. We can do a little bit.
So I can take it with me?
Looking at patterns.
I can take it with me. It's invaluable for you.
No. You should be so lucky. We had a problem. Somebody tried to smuggle its eggshell out of the country a little while ago, and they were actually caught and fined quite a heavy fine.
It was a little joke.
And if this one could be with you, oh, what a wonderful world this would be.
Het Canterbury Museum in Christchurch, New Zealand, is niet alleen een belangrijk natuurhistorisch museum, maar ook een van de belangrijkste musea ter wereld op het gebied van poolonderzoek. Dit museum bezit een hele grote poolbibliotheek en een verzameling unieke dingen die hebben te maken met Scott, Shackleton en Amundsen, kortom de grote poolreizigers. En ik sta hier naast de grootste, namelijk naast Roald Amundsen, die als eerste de Zuidpool heeft betreden.
En iedereen hier in dit museum zit aan zijn neus. Dus ook ik. Want men zegt, als je maar genoeg aan deze neus zit, dan krijg je 6 grote jongens, als je tenminste getrouwd bent. Dus wie weet. Christchurch was very important for the polar expeditions as a starting point, I think, in the beginning of the century.
From 1901, it was the main setting or point for all British expeditions. Yeah. Certainly, Hobart and Tasmania was host to a number of other expeditions at that time.
Which for British expedition, but I see here also the sledge of Amundsen, and that he was Swedish or Norwegian.
Norwegian.
Norwegian, he was Norwegian. So how became the sledge here in the museum?
Well, Sir Joseph Kinsey was the agent for Scott, that's the ship's agent. Hmm. He was a very wealthy man, and he also was a great collector. So that once he established a link with the Antarctic, he started an Antarctic collection, and using the money he had, he purchased a number of items, including the sledge at the back of me, where it had been left by Amundsen in Hobart at the return from his polar journey.
And is it the original sledge, are you sure?
That's the original sledge, absolutely.
And he was on the South Pole?
Yes,
yes. And made the whole expedition to the South Pole and back?
That's certainly our information.
Yeah.
The steel underneath us used to be called German silver, now we call it stainless steel. That was one of the innovations that he introduced to dog sledging. It stopped the snow from building up underneath and holding the sled up.
Oh, this, you can hear it, yes. You've been on the South Pole by yourself many times, I think.
Three times.
And you did a very special job. Tell me about it, about restoring.
Once Operation Deep Freeze started, it was possible, because they operated also, this is the United States effort, from Christchurch, was it possible for New Zealanders to go to the Antarctic and carry out work of their own. And one of the most important things we found should have been done is the 3 huts, the huts from Ernest Shackleton and the 2 huts left by Scott, which had remained full of ice since they left them, should be restored. In other words, we had to take all the ice out and see what was inside. And that was a very long and difficult job. But they're now really museum in their own right, museums in their own right.
But there are no visitors in that museum?
Oh, yes. There's a number of tourist ships come through.
And you can go in that?
Mainly from South America, the South American side. They come around and they stop in McMurdo Sound, mainly to visit the historic huts.
But you were the first going in the hut after Shackleton and the other polar travelers were there?
Certainly in 2 cases, that's true, yes.
What was the feeling after all those years, after 60 years coming there?
Well, that would be the Discovery Hut, which was we were the first in there. You had a feeling like you were entering, as I imagine an Egyptologist would feel as he entered a tomb for the very first time. You had a feeling there was presence, there was someone else with you. You didn't, not anyone that threatened you, just some kindly presence. And a feeling of great reverence for the whole place, so that even though there were 4 of us in the team, as soon as we entered the building, we spoke in whispers, as you would in a cathedral and so on. We don't know why, but we did. That's very overpowering.
Did you find personal things then? What kind of thing? Books, of course, I think.
Books, all the supplies. Yeah. In one case, even the plate with the knife and fork and a half-eaten meal still on the plate, where the ship had come to pick up the party and they just got straight up on the table and rushed.
They waited already for half a year, so, yeah. And did you find notes?
Notes, yes, a number of notes.
Yes.
Mainly notes that have been left for other parties. The idea in Antarctica is if you leave one depot for another, you always leave a note to say you've been, and so the other party will know what's happening. And very often those parties picked the notes up at the end of the operations and brought them to the hut. So we found quite a number of those.
And you left all the things there?
And a few things except for what you see here, yes.
What is from the hut, from Discovery Hut?
Well, if we go around the corner, there's
Perhaps you can go around the corner, right. Yes.
This is a representation of the Discovery
Hut. That's a reconstruction.
A reconstruction. You'll find a large number of Huntley and Palmer's biscuits in tins which have never been opened. And those biscuits are still very crisp, very, very edible. all this types of equipment, man hauling harness, dog, snow shoes, books, as you mentioned, supplies.
But these are not from the hut?
These are all from the hut.
So you take some stuff with you to New Zealand?
Yes, some of that was done, it all had to be done under permit.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, that today you're not allowed to remove anything from there. But before there was any restrictions and we were setting up this museum, we gained government approval to bring a limited amount of material back for display.
And the microscope is also from the hut?
The microscope is from the hut.
So these things were 50 years or more on the South Pole, yeah. And now they're here in the museum?
Completely covered in ice.
Are there also in the library manuscripts of Scotland and
Yes, in our archives we have probably the best collection in the world of material from those British expeditions.
And is it possible for us to see one manuscript of Scott? He died on South Pole, of course. Is that possible, do you think?
I think it could be arranged, yes.
Yeah? Mm. I'd like to see a letter of Scott or yeah. Some handwriting. Well, can you arrange that?
I'll certainly try, yeah.
We'll wait for you then.
All right.
Yeah.
We do have a copy of one here, you know.
Yeah, no, not a copy. No. I'd like to see an original.
It's a matter of all I'm hesitant about is that seeing it's lunchtime, the archivist may be away at lunch.
So, we're waiting for you. Right.
That's that Shackleton machine I talked about. Okay.
Is Paulina eten aan het halen?
Ja, soufflé.
What? Yeah.
I managed to find that letter from Scott.
Here in the canteen?
Yes.
And that's an original one.
That's an original one written in 1901 from South Africa.
Yes.
Announcing his arrival in Lyttelton and making arrangements for the supply of various pieces of equipment. It's a four-page letter.
And it's here from the collections of the
it's
library?
One of our collections from the archives, yes.
Yes.
Robert
Falcon Scott. Yes. He was very sincerely, yes. He's mentioning New Zealand here.
Yes, he's on his way out to New Zealand.
This was for his way out for his last expedition?
His first expedition
his
in 1901.
Expedition. That was the Discovery expedition, yes. And he died a few years later on the second expedition. That's a very expensive letter, I think. It's very costly and very rare, of course. It's unique.
Very valuable.
Yeah. Nieuw-Zeelanders die worden Kiwis genoemd. Ja, als een voetbalelftal tegen Australië speelt, dan is het de Kiwis tegen de kangoeroes of zoiets. Maar wie of wat is de Kiwi nou eigenlijk? Nou, de Kiwi is een vogel die niet kan vliegen. Achter mij staat een heel groot exemplaar, maar dat is overdreven. Die is, ik denk wel 20 keer vergroot, want de echte Kiwi is ongeveer zo groot. Nou, zou je zeggen, dan gaan we die even draaien. Maar dat is ongeveer de allermoeilijkste vogel om te draaien. Je ziet hem wel eens overal. Wat ik al zei, postzegeltjes, blikjes, soep, in boeken, in stripverhalen. Bovenop gebouw, op briefpapier, als hotelmerk. Maar het echt krijg je niet te zien. Hij leeft 's nachts en het is een oervogel. Dat wil zeggen, de enige vogel die nog een beetje op hem lijkt is de moa. Maar die is, zoals iedereen weet, helemaal uitgestorven. Hij is gewoon niet te filmen. En niet dat hij zeldzaam is, want in de bossen lopen er nog tienduizenden honden. Er zijn een aantal soorten, een stuk of vijf. We hebben geprobeerd wat we konden. We hebben hier in een hok geprobeerd om hem ook te draaien. Maar wij kregen met onze menselijke ogen nauwelijks te zien. Laat staan dat Thomas, de cameraman, het lukte. Maar we hebben echt ons best gedaan. De meest vreemde vogel op de wereld blijft ook voor ons grotendeels verborgen. Helaas. Don't know much about